Morning, everyone, and can I welcome members to the 11th meeting in 2017 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private, and it is proposed that the committee takes item five in private. Item five is the consideration of the Child Poverty Scotland Bill. So does the committee agree to consider item five in private? Thank you very much. Agenda item two is instruments subject to affirmative procedure, and the two affirmative instruments for consideration today are the Draft Transport and Works Scotland Act 2007, Environmental Impact Assessment Regulations 2017, and the Draft Roads Scotland Act 1984, Environmental Impact Assessment Regulations 2017. Both instruments were initially laid before Parliament in draft on the 8th of March 2017. Subsequent to this, the committee's legal advisers identified some drafting inconsistencies and minor errors in both of the instruments. Accordingly, they were withdrawn by the Scottish Government and relayed, with the errors identified having been corrected. They were relayed on the 23rd of March 2017. There are now no points have been raised by our legal advisers on the relayed instruments, so is the committee content with these relayed instruments? Okay. Thanks very much. Agenda item three is instruments subject to negative procedure, and the first instruments for consideration is the Non-Domestic Rates Transitional Relief Scotland Regulations 2017, SSI 2017 number 85. These regulations reduce the amount payable as non-domestic rates for certain properties for 2017-18. The regulations were laid before the Parliament on the 16th of March and come into force on the 1st of April 2017. They do not respect the requirement contained in Section 28(2) of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010, that at least 28 days should elapse between the laying of an instrument, which is subject to the negative procedure, and the coming into force of that instrument. Accordingly, does the committee agree to draw the regulations to the attention of Parliament under Reporting Ground G? The instrument fails to comply with the requirements of Section 28(2) of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act. So does the committee agree to draw the regulations to the attention of Parliament under Reporting Ground G? We do. Thank you very much. And does the committee also agree to find the failure to comply with Section 28 to be acceptable in the circumstances as outlined in correspondence from the Scottish Government, published as part of our papers today? Thank you. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the remainder of the negative instruments before us today, which include the Transport and Works Scotland Act 2007, Applications and Objections Procedure Amendment Rules 2017, SSI 2017, number 74, or the Little Loch, Broom, Scallops, Several Fishery Order 2017, SSI 2017, number 77, or the Valuation Appeal Committee Procedure in Appeals under the Valuations Acts Scotland Amendment Regulations 2017, SSI 2017, number 78, or on the Road Traffic Permitted Parking Areas and Special Parking Area Angus Council Designation Order 2017, SSI 2017, number 79, or on parking attendants wearing of uniforms, Angus Council Parking Area Regulations 2017, SSI 2017, number 80, or on the road traffic parking applications, Angus Council Regulations 2017, SSI 2017 number 81, or on the road traffic permitted parking area and special parking area, Stirling Council Designation Order 2017 SSI 2017 number 82, or in the parking attendants wearing of uniforms, Stirling Council Parking Area Regulations 2017 SSI 2017 number 83, or on the road traffic parking adjudicators, Stirling Council Regulations 2017 SSI 2017 number 84. So, is the committee content with these instruments? Many thanks. Which takes us to agenda item 4. Thank you, Colin. Which is a contract third party rights Scotland bill. And today we welcome James Rust, who is a partner at Morton Fraser, specialising in agricultural law. And we are delighted indeed to welcome him here today to the committee. Mr. Fraser, you are indeed most welcome, and thank you for taking the time to come with us, come and be with us today. I have the first question for Mr. Rust, and the question is regarding the need for a statutory approach. And the Bill team and the Scottish Law Commission have indicated that case law is unlikely to develop quickly enough to deal with the problems identified in the law and that statutory rules are needed. Can you outline your own views on the need for statutory rules for third-party rights, please?
Yes, fairly briefly, I would say. I think it is a necessary step to ensure that the law changes in an appropriate way. I'm not an academic lawyer in any sense. I'm a practitioner, and I had to remind myself of the difficulties with the JQT position because it has actually ended up as a backwater, I think, in relation to practitioners' approach to contract law. There are one or two specialist areas that deal with it a lot, but otherwise, I think it has become or it has fallen into a state of disuse because of its difficulties and its uncertainty. And therefore, I think legislation is a good idea.
Excellent. Thank you very much. I'm going to turn now to default rules, and the provisions in the bill set out the default position. Contracting parties are free to make express provisions to the contrary. Could you outline to the committee to what extent you agree with this approach and why, please?
I do agree with the approach. I think it's important to give as much flexibility as possible to contracting parties to adjust and come to their own basis of understanding. And therefore, I think the introduction of a default position is a good one because it allows the necessary flexibility that parties may be seeking.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can we move now to Alison Harris's questions, please?
Good morning. As you're aware, there are a range of third parties in the agricultural sector, and you know, I'm thinking, for example, maybe spouses, who benefit financially from the partnership agreements that are used to run the farms, although they're not actually party to those agreements. Can you explain in more detail what kind of third-party rights exist in the agricultural sector, and what are the most important examples that, in your view?
I'll try. I've given this a little bit of thought. It's the agricultural sector is a business sector like any other, and it is typified by contracts between A and B. And not often do you come across, frankly, a C in whatever context that might be. Consequently, there are possibilities where you may have farm land owned by an individual. The farm may be worked by a partnership, and there may be a contract farming arrangement, perhaps, that might hang off that. And consequently, you do see situations where there may be three parties with different rights attaching to it. But more typically it's a matter of relationship between A and B, and therefore I would say that there isn't a particular issue that I have come across that might mean that this change of the law might have a significant impact on farming. Your comment about spouses who are not engaged in the partnership but who are actually involved in the farming enterprise, if you like, is an interesting one. And certainly that, to that extent, there may well be some impact on family law situations, which have been particularly difficult, and there have been difficult cases involving that.
Before we go any further, I should very much declare an interest in this section of questioning, being a farmer myself. And I apologise to the committee for not having done so earlier in the proceedings. Alison, have you got further questions you want to ask?
Could I just really look at the impact of the current law? You know, one of the main criticisms of the common law and third-party rights is that the scope is uncertain. So the other is that the irrevocability rule, did I say that correctly, makes it difficult to amend or cancel third-party rights. You know, what is your view of these general criticisms, and what is the impact of the problems, if any, on the agricultural sector?
My view is that those problems make the law almost unworkable, in the sense that it doesn't, I think, give any opportunity for flexibility if circumstances change before a third party has an entitlement to operate the right that may be granted. And I think that partly explains, or rather largely explains, why it is an area ripe for legislative change.
Thank you.
Could I just ask you, I mean, I think this is a growing area of potential problem in the agricultural sector. You mentioned specifically contractors and other parties involved in and around agricultural law at this time. Would you like to expand on contractors, agricultural contractors, instead of and contract farming, I dare say, as well, in terms of tenancies?
Yes, I mean, there's a... I don't want to stray into agricultural holdings, because, I mean, that's a topic on itself, but the fact of the matter is that the state of the law in agricultural holdings is in a constant state of flux and uncertainty, and therefore I think you're correct in your presumption that other forms of farming have become more and more popular, I think, as an alternative to agricultural holdings per se. Consequently, there are a number of contracting arrangements that are entered into between the farmer, landowner, and a contractor, or indeed a partner, perhaps, for a particular season to farm the land and to get a profit off it. So that the agricultural sector is typified by a number of different arrangements for working the land beyond simply agricultural holdings and the traditional landlord and tenant approach.
Yes, the more one thinks about it, the more areas there are in that area, such as seasonal lets, grass park lets.
Yeah, absolutely. Grass park lets are very popular, but of course, there is a seasonality about it, and so investment into the land is pretty minimal unless the landlord is going to do that himself for whatever reason. But yes, I mean, there are a number of varying types of contracts which allow for the land to be worked by someone other than the landowner himself.
Indeed. I mean, how many are third parties, as many as you can have, or fourth parties? I'm thinking of someone who takes a seasonal let and then gets another contractor to put fertiliser onto that land for them, absolutely nothing to do with the person who's originally let the land to on a seasonal let basis.
Indeed, and so there is the connection between the landowner and the fertiliser spreader is quite detached. Equally, I think the landowner would want to know whether fertiliser is to be spread, and so commonly that would have been a matter of discussion, I think, between the landowner and the grazier, and a basis for the commercial arrangement arising from that would have been reached. Either he would be on a softer rent, perhaps, to account for the investment that that he would be putting into the land, or indeed sometimes the landowner may have made a contribution himself.
Okay, right, thank you. I think we've exhausted that for the meantime. Monica, would you like to...
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Rust. Unlike the convener, I don't have any special knowledge of agriculture or fertiliser. Nonetheless, in previous evidence sessions, the committee's heard that in many other sectors, construction being one example, that legal workarounds seem to be used to get around the problems in the current law on third-party rights. Are there any workarounds which are used in the agricultural sector to grant rights to third parties? And if so, what are they, and what are the benefits and the disadvantages that they offer?
I have given that some thought, and I can honestly not say that I've come across any. There isn't a standard collateral warranty, for example, that we pull out the drawer every time we deal with some form of new tenancy arrangement or contract arrangement. In the old days, there were when limited partnership agreements were much more popular than they were now, then you occasionally would have a back letter of some sort, but it usually tended just to be between the parties. In other words, there wasn't necessarily a third party involvement in those. I'm sorry, I have racked my brains, but I've not come across anything particular to agriculture. I mean, clearly, in some of the bigger farming operations, they may well be involved in significant construction contracts, and consequently, to that extent, and I'm aware that construction does have a number of collateral warranty approaches to subcontracting and that sort of thing, and so to that extent, farmers may become involved in such warranty arrangements. But particular to agriculture and the practice of that, I haven't been able to think of anything, I'm afraid.
No, that's helpful. That's a clear answer. I think from previous sessions, again, the construction example was that where collateral warranties are quite commonly used, you know, clients and practitioners might be quite wedded to that approach, and we wonder to what extent the new law would be used. The other issue we've looked at is the black hole of non-liability. The Scottish Law Commission has indicated that the bill will make it easier for businesses to avoid what it calls this black hole of non-liability, which currently reduces protection for company groups. Again, speaking today about agriculture, do you agree with that? And if so, can you explain what change that might have in relation to agriculture?
I agree with it as a proposition, because I understand it. I don't think it will have a particular resonance in agriculture, because we don't tend to operate with group companies in agriculture. I mean, there are one or two substantial operations that may find themselves in that situation where they have two or three different companies that are linked, but most farming operations are pretty straightforward. They're either individuals or they're partnerships, and occasionally you may have a limited company. I suppose you might have a trading company as a sub-company of the limited company, perhaps if there's a farm shop or something of that order. So you can see that there might be a relevance in those circumstances. But for, I would say, the vast majority of cases, it's not an issue, I think, for agriculture.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, many thanks. David, Mr. Torrance, if you'd like to.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Given that the bill seeks to provide greater clarity, do you think the provision in the bill are clear and resolve some of the uncertainty associated with the current law?
Yes, I think the bill is clear, and I think it will resolve uncertainty. I think it'll be interesting to see how it's received by practitioners, because I think people as practitioners have got used to the state of uncertainty and therefore have factored it into their practices. And what this does, or what it will do, is I think provide an opportunity for quite some significant rethinking of their approaches. I think, like everything else, trying to get people to move off something that they feel familiar with and a regime that they are comfortable with, albeit that it has its difficulties, into a new place, will take a little time. But one would hope that the advantages will be perceived fairly quickly.
Can you give any tangible examples within the agricultural sector?
Again, I gave that some thought, and I'm afraid I cannot think of anything which would have me rushing to the act to say, right, I'm going to change my styles here, there, and everywhere. But we're constantly reviewing and updating, and certainly we'll have this bill in front of, or this act when it becomes an act, we'll have this act in front of us, and we'll look at our standard form offer and standard form leases and see if there's anything that we want to stick in there to make reference to this. But I mean, the bill, when it becomes an act, will apply across the board in any event. The common law is to be done away with. So we'll be into a new regime come what may.
And do you think the bill will improve the law in relation to the agricultural, and if so, how?
I think it will do so in the sense that agriculture, as I said earlier, is a commercial operation, and therefore this clarifies certain area of law which affects commercial contracts, and therefore there will be benefits to be had in particular circumstances. So, yes, in the right circumstance.
Thank you.
Mr. McMillan, you want to ask a question?
Yeah, thank you. Just a supplementary to David Torrance's question. In your answer a few moments ago, Mr. Rust, you highlighted that you think the bill is clear and it will resolve uncertainty. Now, with that being the case, do you then consider it will be a reality that the costs of actually going into the contracts could then be that bit cheaper for those who are going to enter into the contracts going forward?
I don't think it'll have a material effect on cost, because I think there is much more. There are many more things which bear on cost than simply this particular change in the law. If it reduces the side documentation that occasionally is introduced in particular circumstances, and again I come back to construction as the example, if people can build in the necessary rights into the contract itself without having to think about a separate side position, then what it might well do, I think, is speed things up, and that may have the effect of reducing cost, because a lot of cost is incurred simply in the time taken to get things done. And if you can simplify the process, then I think you will hopefully take some cost out of the procedure.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. In other sectors, there's been some suggestion that there might not be an uptake of the new legislation. So do you think that the parties in the agricultural sector will use the new rules in the bill, or is there a risk that they will continue to use existing legal structures such as they are to set up third party rights?
I think that is a risk. I've probably touched on that already. So I think probably some fairly clear direction from academics, possibly the Law Society, as to where this might actually have positive application and the benefits of that might not be a bad thing. As practitioners, we are always hugely busy, and trying to open our mind to something new such as this is always a constant challenge. So the more encouragement that we can get that there's actually benefit to this, and it's not just more legislation for legislation's sake, the better.
Right. Okay, thank you very much. Mr. McMillan, over to you.
Thank you. Well, just on that latter point then, regarding the the benefits. Obviously, much, but not all, of the focus of the bill has been upon the various sectors which certainly will benefit from the bill. And you've touched upon earlier on in your earlier comments that much of the contracts that take place are between basically the two individuals, notwithstanding the odd contract with the larger agricultural providers. But do you think that the bill will also benefit individuals as well as businesses? And if so, can you provide more detail about how you think there would be these benefits?
Well, I think every business has behind it an individual. So to that extent, I think there will be individual benefit to be had from this. In the agricultural industry, there are many, many great businesses, great and small, and some of them are sole businesses. And I think through a process of evolution, one would hope that there will be greater utilization of the third-party provisions contained within this bill to allow individuals to benefit from that.
Okay.
Sorry, it's crystal ball stuff, really.
Right. Okay. And certainly sections 4 to 6 of the bill stop the contracting parties modifying or cancelling a third-party right. Do you think that these sections of the bill provide the right balance between the rights of contracting parties to change their mind and the rights of third parties?
Yes, I mean, I think that's been thought through reasonably carefully, and I think it does strike the right balance. I think one of the difficulties with the law as it is at present is lack of flexibility, and what this does is introduce the necessary balances, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Are you doing arbitration or not?
And certainly section 9 of the bill allows... Section 9 of the bill is regarding the arbitration agreements, and do you have any comments regarding this particular section between the contracting parties to operate in respect of third-party rights, and what impact do you think the new rules on arbitration will have on the agricultural sector?
I think the introduction of an arbitration provision is sensible, and I think it is right to extend that to third parties in the way that it does. And I think it integrates quite neatly within the existing legislation. So I think that all works quite well. Agriculture is not unknown for its disputes, and there are various ways in which those disputes can be settled. Arbitration is one of them, certainly, but mediation would be another. Scottish Land Court would be another in relation to landlord and tenant. So there are various routes that can be taken in the event of dispute in the agricultural context, and I think this would simply be an enhancement in relation to the arbitration arrangements which are already in place.
Okay, thank you.
This is probably an unfair question, but you have mentioned that the agricultural law is an area not unknown to dispute, and not also unknown to not fulfilling ECHR requirements. Do you think that the proposals here are ECHR compliant in terms of the fairness proposed in terms of arbitration, given how much time this Parliament has spent in the regard of ECHR compliance and fairness?
I would say so. There was nothing that I read in this that was unfair or unreasonable on anybody. I'm well aware of the sensitivities of that situation, but I think it is correct that it allows a third-party locus within an arbitration procedure, and I think that must be only right. I think not to do that might well actually lead you into greater difficulty.
Yep. Okay. Thank you very much. A final question from Monica. Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you. In our other sessions, we've been taking cognizance of the speed of law reform, and we've heard from other witnesses that some of the problems in the Scots law of third-party rights have been around since at least the Second World War. On this basis, do you think there's an argument that the pace of law reform has been too slow?
Well, I think that must be the case. In the sense that I think Scots law was always played second fiddle to UK legislative change when we had to work through Westminster. And I mean, that was a well-known set of circumstances, which I think meant that there was a lot of very good legislative change being spoken about in the Law Commission, but there really wasn't the parliamentary time to deal with it. And since we've had the Scottish Parliament, obviously the dam, you know, the dam has burst, and we've got on with it. I think in relation to this particular issue, what has happened is that practitioners have just got on with the job of life and made do with the law in all its imperfections. And we're eventually catching up with this particular imperfection. So I think to characterise this issue as one which has been particularly slow and noteworthy because of that, I don't think that's fair. I think it's a part of a wider problem which we're in the process of dealing with, would be my personal view.
Okay. One of the aims set out by the Scottish Law Commission is to, I suppose, increase the usage of Scots law. So I think, is it the 1999 Act, which applies in England and Wales? So, you know, that's been relied upon in Scotland. Do you think that if we can get this right and we have an Act in Scotland that's fit for purpose, that there'll be less use of other forms of law?
Absolutely. I'm sure that must be the case. I mean, if we can provide our own solution to the issue as we're doing here, then I'm sure people will turn to it. My only caveat to that is, again, I come back to the point that people are familiar with what they know, and if it works, albeit that it's an English legislation that they're using, then they'll need to be persuaded, need to be educated and persuaded that this now exists, and the intention is that they turn to this rather than than utilise an English Act.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else got any final questions? Mr. McMillan?
It's just on that point again, and touched upon this earlier. If this Act, this bill, when it becomes an Act, when that's in operation, if there is the perception, but also the reality that this could actually save costs, it could save money for certainly for the legal firms, and also time for the legal firms, then would that not be one of the main drivers for the legal firms to actually then use this piece of legislation as compared to what it's currently doing?
Yes, I mean, if it eases the process, then obviously that would be something that people would want to make use of. Once that is recognised, then I think the benefit on cost savings should ensue from that. But it's sometimes it's not just cost that is the driver. I mean, it's about utility, practicality, speed of process as well. All of these things have a bearing. So I think you have to look at it in a slightly broader sense.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, it just remains for me to thank Mr. Rust for coming and giving us his evidence today. Thank you very much. If in the dark hours of the night or subsequently you or any of your colleagues at Morton Fraser or indeed any other law firms dealing in agricultural law, on reflection and having heard your evidence, if there's any other matters that you consider would be helpful to us in arriving at producing the best piece of law we can in this regard, and we're very pleased to hear from you subsequently. But in the meantime, thank you very much for your help this morning, Mr. Rust. Thank you. I'll now suspend the meeting just for a second to allow the witnesses to change. Shall we resume? And we'll now move to our next witness providing evidence in the contract third party rights Scotland Bill today. And so my great pleasure to welcome David Wedderburn, who is a forensic architect representing the Royal Incorporation of Architects in Scotland. Now invite questions from members, and the first questions I have myself, and it is a need for a statutory report approach. And the Bill team and the Scottish Law Commission have indicated that case law is unlikely to develop quickly enough to deal with the problems identified in the law, and that statutory rules are needed. Can you outline your own views on the need for statutory rules for third-party rights, please?
Yes, we feel that there is need because with the common law approach, the law is, first of all, uncertain, and the development of the law is also uncertain because it depends on what cases come before the courts and how the courts deal with it. Problem at the moment in the construction industry, and I notice you have been referring to that already, the approach to third-party rights has been through a lot of separate contracts, collateral warranties, and the kind of people that are needing these assurances because they're exposed either because they've lent money or are occupying properties constructed and designed by under other contracts and are liable for their maintenance, or are buying properties for investment, all need certainty because they're hazarding quite a lot of money, both capital and expenditure. And therefore, at the moment, even though there is the common law right, they tend in both Scotland and England to use collateral warranties. Another driver is that a lot of these third parties wanting third party rights are based, have headquarters in England, in London, and tend to have English solutions. And certainly at the up till when I was in practice, till about 5-10 years ago, that we were using even in England, notwithstanding the Third Party Rights Act, they were still using collateral warranties. So it'll take a lot of persuading for these institutions to move over. I, as well as being representative of the RIS, I'm also on the drafting committee of the Scottish Building Contracts Committee, and there we have actually drafted third-party rights into standard form building contracts with the assistance of Professor Hector McQueen, and they haven't been used very much, and they are a bit cumbersome because of the problem of irrevocability and trying the requirement to lodge the rights in books of council of session or some other kind of delivery to make them enforceable. So I think the new law will assist in getting some of the cumbersome aspects of the present attempts to use third-party rights in the future.
We've heard a little about the 1999 Act in England, but not a huge amount of uptake since of what that offers to contracting parties. Have you any comments to make on that?
Well, I'm not an English lawyer, and I don't and I don't have extensive experience of operations in England, but we have been involved in developments which involve English developers, and they still think in terms of collateral warranties rather than using third-party rights.
But even now?
Even now.
Almost 20 years later?
Yes, it's taken... commercial law moves slowly, I think.
Right. Well, certainly that's consistent with what we've been hearing from others as well. Moving now to default rules, and the provisions in the bill set out the default position. Contracting parties are free to make express provisions to the contrary. Could you outline to the committee to what extent you agree with this approach, and if so, why?
Yes, we at the RIS, I think, agree with this approach because we want to have it these third-party rights established clearly, and have the non-applicability as an exception to the rule. There are benefits to architects in having all their legal obligations set up under the one document, and anything that makes it uncertain that these rights have been established will encourage other third parties to insist upon extra contractual arrangements. Anything that can, say, establish all these third party rights under the architect's appointment would be to the benefit of everyone.
Right, thank you. That's clear cut. Now move to Alison Harris for the next question, please.
Good morning. In your written evidence, you explain that third-party rights are needed in commercial developments to protect the position of the funders, purchasers and tenants. Could you expand on why third-party rights are so important to commercial developments, and are there any other areas of construction where third-party rights are important?
Yes, well, the ones in relation to funders, purchasers and tenants are important. In relation to funders, the funder is extending a large amount of money, a loan, to somebody, and the only security is the property. And that security is damaged if the property is defective in any manner. And therefore, they need recourse against those that they think may have caused the damage to the property. And that's why they always insist. In fact, they have special kinds of third-party rights. In addition to having recourse in relation to defects, they also usually insist on what are called step-in rights, which means that if the contractor the developer goes bust, for example, they can step in, take over the construction from the developer and finish it so that they again protect their investment. And this, in relation to purchasers, they need to know what they're buying. If they, because the problem with building buildings are you have latent defects. So it's not often not patently showing that there is a problem with the building, and a forward purchaser can purchase what they think is a perfectly good building, and then there are loads of defects. And with regard to tenants, normally commercial tenants are let on a full repairing and insuring lease, and therefore they are liable if there's something wrong with the building. So again, they need to protect their position.
And are there any other areas then of the construction that you can think of with third party rights?
Those are the main ones. You can, well, the other area is what I would say the kind of Panatown type situation, that it is quite common for developers to have a group arrangement where, and they transfer the ownership of their property to one member of the group company, while another member of the group company will actually enter into the contracts to actually have them built. And there you have a situation of contract with no loss and somebody suffering a loss with no contract. And that's an ideal situation to have a third party right so that they are protected.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll now explore collateral warranties with Monica Lennon. Ms. Lennon, please.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Mr. Wedderburn. You've touched on it already in your first response to the Convener. I've had a look at your written evidence as well, where you explain that the uncertainty in the current law means that parties in the construction sector normally use collateral warranties. I've listened to your earlier comments. Is it simply just that commercial lawyers are creatures of habit? Is that what's going on?
especially lenders and banks like to have a piece of paper that they can show that they can pursue, raise an action on. So it's an educational task once we have the bill as an act to persuade them that we can point to the contract and the provisions in the contract which they can rely on.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I suppose what I'm wondering is, it sounds like the use of collateral warranties is very well established in light of this, of the uncertainty in terms of common law. But in your evidence, it appears that collateral warranties are quite difficult to arrange logistically. So it's not an easy option, perhaps. So could you explain what some of those practical problems are?
I've had circumstances where we've had to dash off to the Highlands. It got a deal about to sign, and one of the parties is on a holiday in a cottage up far north, and send two solicitors up to stand at his door until he signed the document, then take it back so we can do a deal the next day. So these things can happen.
Right. Is that a fairly typical example, or are there others?
No, that one was unusual. Usually we manage to get everyone lined up and all together and everyone signed, but it's like herding cats sometimes.
Also in your written evidence, you indicate that a technical problem with collateral warranties is that sometimes the rights and benefits in the warranty are not aligned with initial contract terms. Could you expand on that point?
It is a problem that collateral warranties, they're independent legal documents and can be drafted in any way parties like. And the danger is if people take them off the shelf from one development and apply them to another. The advantage with the third party rights approach is that it automatically they're aligned with the contract because the rights are written into the contract. But with a separate document, it could enter into all sorts of things which don't align with the underlying contract.
Okay. We've also heard from other witnesses, I think similar to yourself, that in the short term, collateral warranties will probably be used for some time instead of the new rules. Do you agree with that view? I mean, you've touched on the need for education. How do you go about educating practitioners?
Yes. Well, what the first thing we'll be doing as an incorporation, we'll be issuing practice notes to members alerting them to the new when the Act becomes an Act. The problem is, of course, often developers, they approach their architect when they're thinking about doing a development, so that is the point to bring to their attention these approaches. But if they're going to a bank to get funding, the bank will go to their own lawyers rather than, because they won't involve anyone in the development team. And that's where it needs education of lawyers as well.
Okay. So how will that be addressed within the banking sector?
I'm not sure. It's not my area of expertise.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica. I now move to Alison Harris, who's going to talk about another subject.
Yes, I was going to ask you about the Scottish Law Commission has indicated that the bill will make it easier for businesses to avoid what it calls the black hole of non-liability, which currently reduces protection for company groups. Do you agree? And if so, can you explain what the impact of this change will be in the construction sector?
Well, I've touched on that, I think, in relation to the kind of Panatown type situation where you have one member of the group being contracting to get the thing built, and then as soon as it's finished, it's passed on to another part of the group which holds all the property. And in the present law, there is the danger that, although there are a number of, including the House of Lords, have then used fancy footwork to try and bridge the gap, but it's much a nicer legal way to just create third-party rights, which allows all the members of the group to benefit from the original contract.
Okay, so thank you. So you think it's maybe more cleaner?
Yes, it's cleaner.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. McMillan, over to you.
Thank you. Sections 4 to 6 of the bill stop the contracting parties modifying or cancelling a third-party right. Do you think that these sections of the bill provide the right balance between the rights of contracting parties to change their mind and also the rights of third parties?
Yes, I think so. The important thing, as I've indicated before, with regard to the kind of people in the construction industry that are looking for warranties, is to make sure that the underlying contract can't change under their feet. And so I think it is very important that they are able to rely upon it. So I think the provisions making it quite clear when things can be cancelled, and also the ones when they can still rely upon it even though the underlying contract may have subsequently changed, I think are very useful for the kind of people in the construction industry who will rely on third-party warranties, rights.
Okay. Certainly, with the discussion we've had this morning and also in previous sessions, much but not all the focus has been on various business sectors which will benefit from this bill. And do you think that the bill will also benefit individuals as well as businesses? And if so, can you provide further examples or more detail about who you think will benefit?
Well, my main experience is through organisations as third parties, at least companies and business partnerships, etc. But these are all made up of individuals, and to the extent that a lot of our members are traders, sole traders, and are therefore individuals, they'll benefit from having less paperwork and having the issue of third-party rights established right at the beginning under their appointment, rather than what often happens now is towards the end of a job, having already entered into their appointment, somebody comes along and says, by the way, you need to sign all this great sheaf of collateral warranties. So hopefully that situation will be less likely to occur.
On the issue of the collateral warranties and also what's in this bill, with the operation of collateral warranties, notwithstanding the fact that also they've been used for quite some time, and as Monica Lennon was asking earlier, are the protections, are they kind of creatures of habit to use these? Are they? Do you think they will continue to be an expensive route of legal practice? Do you think when this bill is passed, in whichever shape or form, do you think this will actually be a cheaper method of operation as compared to the collateral warranties?
Yes, certainly it'll be cheaper, although given the scale of some of the large commercial operations, the percentage of saving will be quite small. But I think even more important, there'll be less hassle, I think, in doing it this way. It's a neater way of doing it and causes less disruption to the parties involved in the development.
I've got one final question, Kimira. When you gave your example earlier of two solicitors being sent up to the Highlands to stand at the door, I take it that was before that this Parliament passed the legal writings counterpart and delivery Scotland Act.
Yes, a number of years ago.
Okay, thank you very much.
Right, thank you very much. Mr. Torrance, you've got some of the final questions, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Arbitration and impact it's had on the construction sector. In your written evidence, you explained that it's currently difficult for third parties to join in arbitrations dealing with collateral warranties. You indicate that Section 9 of the bill will make it easier for multiple party arbitrations to take place. Could you expand on this point and explain what the advantages are for multi-party arbitrations in the construction sector?
The arbitration has been a varying thing in the construction industry over the last few years. When I was first practicing an architect back in the 70s, the standard form had the default of arbitration, but it fell into disrepute because the arbitration was relied on articles of 1695 or somewhere around then. It was rather antiquated and it could go on and on. So there was a move in later years to move to court proceedings. But since the Arbitration Act 2010, we have the SBCC at least, who are the major drafters of Scottish building contracts, have moved back to arbitration being the default position for dispute resolution. And therefore, it is very likely that any underlying contracts will have arbitration as the means of dispute resolution. And that then creates problems for third parties who are not party to the underlying construction contract being involved in any arbitration. So we welcome this approach in the third party rights bill to allow them to join in any such proceedings. There is something further which I've just thought of early this morning, so I am not sure how it'll, I haven't thought it fully through, but as you may be aware, construction contracts are subject to the Housing Grants and Construction and Regeneration Act, which gives a right to adjudication on disputes. Now, we'd be an interesting position, well, we already are, of the interaction between the two, but that's something that would need to be borne in mind of how the two interact.
On the speed of law reform, from evidence we've received so far and the problems in Scots law and third-party rights, do you think that reform has been too slow?
No, I think it's good to see it happening and coming up. And I think that the fact that we have a Scottish Parliament has allowed a lot of issues that had lain unresolved for a long time to be addressed by the Parliament, which I welcome. Yes, it's interesting that the third parties were addressed, issue was addressed in England in 1999, but they were coming from a different position where they had privity of contract and therefore no third party rights to begin with. So I'm glad that we've now legislating so we have a proper statutory basis for Scottish third party rights.
Thank you.
Excellent. Any final questions for Mr. Wedderburn? No. In the absence then of there being any other questions, Mr. Wedderburn, it's my pleasant duty just to thank you very much for taking the time to come and give us the benefit of your advice today. And as I have said to other witnesses, if you or other of your colleagues, if matters occur to you on reflection and following this session that you think would be a benefit to us in making good or better law that you haven't managed to convey to us today, please do so subsequently, should you wish. But in the meantime, thank you very much for your help today. Thank you. Now suspend for a moment. Shall we resume again, colleagues, and the final witnesses before the committee today are Craig Connell, QC, who's a partner at Pinsent Masons, and David Christie, who's a senior lecturer in law at Robert Gordon University. So can I welcome both Mr. Connell and Mr. Christie, and thank you very much for coming and joining us today. As before, I have the first question, and the first question is on common law to statutory footing, and the Bill team and the Scottish Law Commission have indicated that case law is unlikely to develop quickly enough to deal with the problems identified in the law and that statutory rules are needed. Can you outline your own views on the need for statutory rules for third party rights, please?
Thank you, convener. Can I just start before I do that, just by thanking the committee for its courtesy in allowing me to rearrange my appointment to come today so that I could attend my colleague's funeral in Ayr, as it happened a week ago, which is very much appreciated. My own view, and I'll let Mr. Christie chip in just in a second, is that this is quite actually a tricky balance for this Parliament to maintain, because although the common law is in a sense cumbersome, it does however have the advantage that it develops over time and things change, different types of case emerge. Third party rights wouldn't have been discussed in the context of collateral warranties 20 years ago. They'd have been discussed in the context of title conditions on people's houses. That's where they were largely to be found. So the common law does sort of shift along in a slightly cumbersome way. And of course, as soon as you put legislation in place, you're then faced with detailed statutory provisions, which may or may not all turn out to be ideal. So I suspect I'm rather more ambivalent about the pros and cons of this, although I recognise that the revocability point that the Law Commission identified, which I realise is another question, is a matter that's not easily resolved by case law.
If I may, I set out some of my reasons for this in the paper which I produced to the committee, but I think it might be helpful just to briefly summarise them. In terms of the broad policy, I think the codification of the common law in this situation is probably necessary if there's a recognised need to have third-party rights. And in general, consensus seems to be that there is a benefit in having third-party rights. And in the construction sector, where there's a value put on pragmatism and flexibility, I think at least having the option of third-party rights would be useful. In Scots law at the moment, and I called it perhaps slightly poetically, a death spiral, but third-party rights are subject to a death spiral because there are no cases coming before the courts to help clarify the existing law. In the absence of clarity in the existing law, nobody is using third-party rights, which means there are no cases coming before the courts to clarify it, and so nothing is happening with third-party rights. And there is a possibility, if the codification occurs as happened in England and Wales, there may be, and I wouldn't necessarily put it any higher than that at the moment, the possibility of a virtuous cycle whereby use of third-party rights increases and it becomes perpetuating to the extent that the more people use it, the more it becomes accepted and the more useful it has. And that's not to say that collateral warranties in the construction context, which I'm most knowledgeable on, wouldn't go away, but there may be changes to the extent to which they're emphasised and used.
Yes, we'll take you to an explanation of your term primordial soup in your evidence later on. But in the meantime, we'll move. Thank you. In the meantime, we'll ask Monica Lennon to take up the uncertainties about the scope of the law. Monica.
Thanks, convener. One of the main criticisms of the common law is that its scope is uncertain. Do you agree with that criticism? And if so, why? Could you give some examples to suggest what extent you think the law needs to be clarified in legislation?
Well, I think partly there's the general perception of lack of clarity, which, as I've said, is sort of self-perpetuating. But that largely comes from, I think you've heard about irrevocability is the particular issue. And the lack of clarity around exactly how third-party rights are constituted in a way that can be binding. And the danger with third-party rights as well is that if there's uncertainty as to constitution, then there's always the risk that some third party, if you're entering a contract, some third party might crawl out of the woodwork and raise a claim against you, which makes them quite scary because there's a lot of uncertainty about where a claim might come from. So third parties, as a result, will simply exclude third-party rights from the contracts altogether. So there's never any questions about it. So I think the sort of inherent uncertainty is the real problem here. I think the Law Commission have plotted a route through how you could interpret the law in one way, but it requires probably more work and the need to argue these cases before court in order to achieve that. And I think the best way to short-circuit the problem, if you think third-party rights are a good idea, which I think they probably are, is to codify them in legislation, essentially to reboot the common law. I was thinking in the train down, it's a bit like if you have a technical problem with your computer, you know, often you will continue to use it and you'll just find a way to get along with the problem. In the construction industry, in some ways, that's collateral warranties. It's not necessarily easy, but it does the job. But what you really need is somebody just to upgrade your system and get rid of that problem altogether. And then at least it gives you a choice about how you keep going.
Okay, so you think this upgrade is a step in the right direction, what's proposed?
Yeah.
Okay, given that the bill seeks to provide greater clarity, do you think the provisions in the bill are clear enough and do they resolve some of the uncertainty linked to the current law?
I've reflected on the supplementary evidence given by the Faculty of Advocates, which I thought was interesting, and they've picked out a number of difficulties with the legislation. Well, I would go not necessarily difficulties, but areas where it's inelegant. And certainly there are sections which are very wordy. I was reflecting on that. I think the conceptual difficulty is that with third-party rights, there's a distinction between the right and where the right comes from. So if you have a contract, the contract contains rights. The way you work out what those rights are is by reading the contract. With third-party rights, the rights have to come from somewhere. So in the legislation, it's what's termed the undertaking, and it's the interpretation of the undertaking that gives you the scope and the parameters of the third party right. And I think the legislation, therefore, is trying to take account of that duality, because so much of what the legislation is trying to do seems to be essentially facilitating the intention of the parties in giving the third party right. I don't know if I'm making sense now.
I'm just about with you there. Mr. Connell, do you want to add to that?
Yes, it is interesting. It probably goes back to the point that I made at the outset, that if I just take revocability as an example, if the law says the right must be irrevocable to work, well, that's pretty clear. Whether it's a good rule or a bad rule, it's clear, and everybody knows the rule, and it didn't cause any problem in the previous regime for third-party rights in relation to titles, because it was always in the title deeds, so it was there. As soon as you then say, well, we want to change the rule, you then get into some of the provisions in the Act, which are, probably quite well designed to create a lot of dispute. But say sections 4 to 6, which has been commented on by other contributors, and I know comes up later. So as soon as you take away the simple position, you find yourself possibly having to create quite a complicated answer in order to cope with the issue that you're dealing with. I was trying to think of another issue about clarity, because I realised this question might arise. The one that just occurred to me, and Mr. Christie will tell me I'm attacking the coherence of the law, but if you want to make things very simple, then you just say, third-party rights can only be created expressly. If you want them, you write them down, they're in the contract, everybody can look them up and see what they are. You don't allow them to be implied, because as soon as you allow them to be implied, you open up a whole range of, well, if they're not there in express terms, and under what circumstances can they be implied? So that there are degrees of certainty. Now, I think Mr. Christie has pointed out to me this morning that if you remove implied, then you create a different position to other areas of the law. It's quite an interesting trade-off between clarity and progress.
Sticking with the current approach that's set out in the bill, Professor Hugh Beale and the Law Society have sort of touched on the complexity of sections 4 to 6. Do you share some of those concerns?
No, absolutely. Now, I make it clear to the members of this committee, I'm a contentious lawyer, so I deal with problems, although I have, for the purpose of assisting this evidence, gone to speak to people who work in other areas, such as drafting documents. So I may be able to assist on some of these points as well. But when I see clauses that talk about reliance and reliance to a material extent, and I go, oh, I wonder what that means. Well, that's, we can litigate over that then. And so on. I think there are a lot of areas in there that are quite difficult to find a simple fix for. There's quite a complex fix here. Now, it may not matter if there aren't that many cases, but it certainly creates a number of areas of complexity. And now, I'm not a parliamentary draftsman, so I'm afraid I haven't come here with a nice, neat, one-sentence solution for you, but I certainly think there's something to be said for wondering whether these provisions are too complicated.
Just to add to that, on the point that Mr. Connell and I discussed beforehand about implied rights, I think that was something the Law Commission considered as to whether or not they should be allowed by implication, because that's different from the approach in some other jurisdictions. I don't have a particular view either way, but the point I made to Mr. Connell was that I think part of the way in which the legislation treats third-party rights is to interpret them essentially as if they were other provisions of a contract. It's just that they happen to give the rights to a third party. So to allow implied rights brings them within the broad sphere of how you interpret contractual provisions, which is to look at the words. Mr. Connell knows all of this. Look at the words in their surrounding look at the words in their surrounding circumstances, and then work out what the party's intention was. So I think if you start to differentiate third-party rights from the broader sphere of contract interpretation, you may find yourself in difficulties, because you're not allowed to use the broader suite of rules to understand how the third-party rights work. And if you haven't got access to that broader suite of rules, then it's harder to work out what the meanings of the rules in third-party rights terms are, which then increases the uncertainty.
Okay. I might pick that up again in some later questions. I'll digest that.
I'm sorry, the secret we're not letting out is that Mr. Christie and I used to work in the same office, so we know each other from long ago, hence some of the discussion.
We like to bring people together on this committee. Thank you.
Professor Beale implied, if my memory serves it correctly, that the English legislation was more straightforward and clear-cut and almost binary. Would that be something that you see that this proposed legislation not providing sufficient clarity? And would you agree with the Faculty of Advocates' response, which you may or may not have seen?
I've seen only sections of the faculty response. I dipped into Professor Beale's evidence, but I regret I didn't have time to read it all. I'm not, although I am qualified in England as well, I'm not sure I can offer a definitive view as to whether the 1999 Act and this Act are, when you compare them, precisely the same, or whether there are material differences.
And not being a practitioner, I wouldn't want to hazard a view particularly on the interpretation of specific provisions, but I did look at the faculty's further response, and I thought actually that seemed like quite an elegant way to deal with it. And certainly from a pragmatic point of view, if you have the Faculty of Advocates who are going to be the ones arguing about this legislation already picking up issues in the drafting, I think we should probably take that into account. I think that possibly the thing with sections 4 to 6 is that they are aimed at addressing specific problems that arose or exist in the current common law. And it's almost like you've a problem has been identified, and this is the drafting fix to sort that problem out, whereas perhaps the faculty's view is to take a more holistic approach to all of these issues.
Right. Okay, I think we should move on. And it appears that move on to me. And regarding default rules and the provision in the bill set out the default position, contracting parties are free to make express provisions to the contrary. Could you outline to the committee to what extent you agree with this approach and why, although you may already have touched on that subject, but if you'd like to further put that on the record, just your views on that question, please.
Party autonomy is the phrase that's usually used, the general principle that so far as possible, parties should be free to put into a contract what they want to put into a contract, and the other party to that contract should be free to accept or reject it leading to a conclusion, and that these provisions ought not to be restricted in any unnecessary way. And I think that's the general principle that's widely applied and should apply here. So the answer would be party autonomy is provided for.
I'd agree with that. I think it's important for parties to have the choice. And I think this Act helps them have a choice where they perhaps don't have a full range of choices compared to other jurisdictions just now. But certainly there are, I can foresee situations where collateral warranties would still be highly useful, even if this Act passes, for example. It might be it takes some of the more basic situations where you use collateral warranties out of the frame and allows you to focus your efforts on the more complex situation. But that would be, again, a matter for choice, and that helps the flexibility in these relatively complex contractual situations.
Right. Oh, okay. Thanks very much. Move now to Alison Harris and her questions.
Morning, gentlemen. Please. Section 2 of the bill abolishes the irrevocability rule so that contracts granting third-party rights can be cancelled or modified. Do you support the abolition of this rule? And if so, why?
I think on this I'll probably defer to Mr. Christie. I think in many of the situations in which third-party rights might have been envisaged in the past, this wouldn't have been an issue. I go back again to the title deed example. It's put in the title deed, well, it's there, and the issue of the title deed being revoked or changed just doesn't arise. If there was a view from, for instance, the construction industry that a more nuanced ability to shift and change is required, then clearly that's not provided for in the current common law, and if you're going to change it, you have to do it by statute.
I think there's a benefit in allowing the parties to agree and construct the third-party rights that suit their particular situation, and if that limits or restricts the extent to which you have to hit certain pre-set criteria, then that's a good thing. I am slightly conscious that I think most of the evidence you've heard will have been from lawyers who are the people who are involved in setting up collateral warranties in these arrangements. And there is, we do need to reflect on the extent to which the beneficiaries of third-party rights and the beneficiaries of collateral warranties will be those who are often buying property and construction sets and you know, the funders and so on. And they obviously have an interest in certainty, and the extent to which there is certainty as to what the third-party right they're getting is important. So I think there's a balance to be struck between revocability and the ability for funders and the beneficiaries of third-party rights to continue to, or to be able to rely upon those rights. And I think that's something the bill sets out to achieve, and that's perhaps why the wording that we've been discussing is fiddly, because it's trying to draw that balance between flexibility in constitution and certainty when it comes to executing the rights.
Okay, thank you.
I'm the first to admit I'm not a lawyer, but just tell me how renunciation might impact on what you've just said, or not at all. I'm just aware of that being part of the Faculty of Advocates evidence, and is that relevant to irrevocability or not?
Well,
and if it's not, just say so.
Well, first of all, I think we could all like to confess not to be lawyers if it was an option for us. I don't have a particular view on renunciation apart from within the sort of general framework of you can't force someone to have a right that they don't want, but I haven't really engage with the reasoning of the Faculty of Advocates any further than that.
I haven't, I confess, convener, engaged with their reasoning at all. One of the complications is, I think, that this bill is dealing with the granting of rights only, because that's what the previous law dealt with. And in many of the situations which arise in practice, there may be an attempt also to impose obligations, just as a previous witness talked about documents going beyond simply saying you have the right to do X. And of course, as soon as you go there, you get into much more complicated territory. Clearly, if it's simply the granting of a right, then the person to whom the right is given can say, no, thank you, I give it up. And that's reasonably straightforward.
Okay, right. Thank you very much. So we now move to Mr. McMillan's questions, please.
Thank you. Good morning. Some of this has been touched upon regarding sections 4 to 6, and certainly these sections stop the contracting parties modifying or cancelling a third party right. And do these sections provide the right balance between the rights of contracting parties to change their mind and the rights of third parties?
I'm not going to reiterate, Mr. McMillan, the general comments about the nature of some of these points. If I was to make an educated guess at it, I suspect is if you need provisions of this kind, then there's been a very fair attempt to try and create a balance between the right of the original contracting parties to say no, and the right of the person who's received this option to insist on it in certain circumstances which are specified. And I think, in a sense, that rather elaborate answer to your very simple question probably gives the clue as to why these provisions are quite complicated.
Yes, I don't think there's that much else I would add beyond what Mr. Connell's just said and what I've said already. It's about partly as well with the conceptual difficulty of separating out the underlying instrument that creates the right and the right itself. And that's something which I don't feel qualified to look at the drafting to deal with, but I think the Faculty of Advocates have had a good think, and it might be one for further reflection.
Yeah. And certainly, in terms of the policy memorandum with the bill, I mean, that states that the legislation will promote the use of Scots law, and based on your experience, do you think that this is correct?
I think there's a prospect of it. Other witnesses have spoken of what you might call the London waiting. In other words, the fact that a lot of transactions are dealt with by people who are advised originally by lawyers in London and so on and so forth, and therefore there's a natural inclination to assume that nothing out of London actually matters. So it's bound, I think, to help. I think, as other witnesses have said, it's perhaps worth remembering that the English partly changed their law because they thought the Scots law was better than the very rigid privity of contract rules that the English had, and the Scots had third-party rights, albeit with some difficulties. But the reality, I suspect, is like all changes come out, people prick up their ears and say, oh, they may well have forgotten jus quaesitum tertio, which they learned when they were at university, because they've not seen it since. Now there's a new act. People will say, oh, what does that do? And may well then sit down and think, can we use it? Does it advantage our clients? So I'd have thought, on balance, the answer is that there is a reasonable prospect of some greater use of Scots law.
I think I'd agree with that based on the literature I've looked at and my own experiences. I don't necessarily think it's the sort of radical change that is going to cause an explosion in the use, but certainly in itself it closes a gap between Scots law and its main competitor in English law, and also aligns it more closely with broader European law. And also I think it's useful as a way of demonstrating, along with the other piece of legislation about counterparties that you mentioned earlier, Mr. McMillan, a way of demonstrating that Scots law is moving forward and recognising where there are areas and is able to start sorting those issues out.
I was going to bring that piece of legislation back in as well. That bill went through this committee, and I recollect that the then minister who took the bill forward, it was a point that he highlighted on numerous occasions. It was about trying to modernise Scots law, and as we heard already this morning, in terms of the SLC bills that have come into the Scottish Parliament, it is just about that modernising and bringing, making Scots law more competitive on that international area.
It must be sensible if you have, if we stick with the construction example for the moment, if we have a project in this jurisdiction, the logic of putting anything in with the law of another jurisdiction is silly. The committee will probably be aware from other evidence that the classic example is the North Sea, where the North Sea has been conducted largely within Scottish jurisdiction, not entirely, but largely, and yet the suites of contracts that have been entered into by the entire industry have largely been dominated almost by default by English law provisions. And in fact, a lot of the disputes disappear elsewhere as well. Now, this is an opportunity at least to edge something forward, I would have thought.
And in terms of, I mean, the construction industries often use standard forms of contract, and the main suites use English law in that, albeit there's a version with a kilt on for the joint contract tribunals one. But, for example, if you can align the law more closely, that makes it easier to tweak the standard forms to apply Scots law, because you don't have to do as much consequential drafting. So if there are other good reasons why you might want to have Scottish jurisdiction, which there will be in terms of logistics and so on, it makes it appealing and makes it easier to use the standard forms.
Some of the evidence we've heard today as well is regarding the workarounds. When this bill passes through the parliamentary process and then becomes an act, clearly there will be an education process that will need to take place. And I accept as well that this isn't a crystal ball exercise, but do you think that in terms of that education process, I mean, how much effort do you think would need to go in to encourage practitioners to actually consider this particular piece of legislation when it comes to the contracts going forward?
My guess, and this is not one for which I have any evidence, is that you probably need to do something. Something needs to be done after the initial activity. In other words, assume the bill becomes an act, the act comes out, it's announced, royal assent date is announced, etc., etc. People pick up their ears, think about it. My own guess is that a year later, everybody's forgotten about it, unless somewhere in the professional organisations there's some effort to reiterate the new scheme. Because the reality with the workarounds, the collateral warranties, I had a long chat with a colleague of mine who does little else but draft construction contracts. And what he tells me is that the drafting still needs to be done. So you still need to work out who's to get the right, who's to give the right, what the terms of the right are there any additional material? All of that still has to be done exactly as before. What you're potentially avoiding by this bill is, as he puts it, the paper chase. So you may be able to put it all in the one contract, provisions for the granting of rights in favour of various parties, as opposed to having, I think he instanced a recent contract where he had 120 collateral warranties, because each of the specialist participants in the building process had to grant warranties in favour of each of the parties with an interest, tenants, funders, and so on. Now, each of these requires another piece of paper. Now, some people like to have their own little piece of paper, as we've heard, but I suspect avoiding a paper trail is always, in principle, a good idea. So if the professional bodies take up the mantle after the Parliament has given them the opportunity, it just needs a bit of consistent education.
Just to add to that, I think that it's also worth, in terms of the education process, the ideas that go into third-party rights, to the extent that in construction cases they're used in collateral warranties, the thinking is already there. These are not, it's not necessarily introducing a whole set of foreign terms into the industry. You know, people understand what collateral warranties do and that third parties can do some of the same things. They will also understand third-party rights if they've got experience in England and Wales, which most of the sort of complex, large construction companies who will be engaging in these large projects that have collateral warranties will understand, because they'll have operated in England and Wales. And Scots lawyers as well will have some familiarity, because we have all studied jus quaesitum tertio or tertio at university. So there isn't, it's a sort of reminder and a bringing up to date, rather than necessarily here's a brand new concept which we all have to get our head round.
Okay. And certainly the SLC also indicated that the bill will make it easier for businesses to avoid what it calls the black hole of non-liability, which currently reduces the protection for company groups. And do you agree with this? And if so, can you outline your reasons why?
I'm a bit cynical about the prospect, to be frank. Speaking as a contentious lawyer, the black hole cases usually tend to arise because somebody hasn't thought it through. Things have happened, and it turns out, as the previous speaker said, the loss is in one place, but the right is in another, and the two aren't matching up. Now, of course, if you haven't thought about it, it doesn't matter what this bill provides. You won't have written it in. If you've thought about it in advance, then, of course, there are already a suite of mechanisms for dealing with this. This will add another one. There aren't that many black hole cases. I think the witness that spoke from the RIS earlier said that the courts sometimes use what he described as fancy footwork to get round them, because the courts don't like the idea of a black hole, because it's just abhorrent. You know, if there is a loss caused by somebody's failure, why should that fall into a black hole as opposed to land on the appropriate person? So there is footwork that can be done. And I'm not myself convinced that this makes much odds to those relatively rare cases where it arises.
Similarly, I think there might be scope to pick off some of those if you have a third-party rights act. I think the SLC used the example in their paper of maybe a group of companies where you might be able to construe the third-party right quite widely to cover companies in the group. But I think the overall problem with black holes defies a simple solution, as the number of dissertations that I have to look at on the master's course in construction law, which look at this issue and try and solve it, will testify to. And I was glad to see that the SLC are looking at ways to progress that themselves, and I wait with interest progress on that matter.
So we're quite long in analysis there in terms of defining the problem. Do you have any solutions, particularly from an academic perspective, given the benefit of advice you've had from many students?
No. it's not something I've yet dared to grapple with, because I think it opens up, conceptually, it opens up, I think, a gap between various classifications of law, between contract law and the law of delict and things like that. And I think while I'm aware that there is a gap there that might be interesting, I think I'd want to delve deep into the literature to come to any view myself. So it's not something the prospect in that particular area is too daunting. I've decided to go for some other areas myself at the moment. The thought of an interesting point of law as well is one which a colleague of Mr. Connell's and a former colleague of mine, he said, if a doctor comes to you, or if you go to the doctor and he says you've got an interesting condition here, that's the worst possible diagnosis you can hear. So having an interesting problem like transferred loss or black holes is not a great thing. So I'm looking forward to others taking forward some work on this, and it's something I will keep an eye out for and think about in the future.
Currently in the too difficult box then. Thank you very much for that. We're now going to yet more detail about collateral warranties, if you have any information left to give us from Monica Lennon.
Yeah, we like to hear about collateral warranties. Sticking again with construction, the construction sector is diverse, so we've got very large companies, we've touched on that earlier, some of which are headquartered in London. Can you give some examples of how collateral warranties are used, bearing in mind that within the sector there's a range of players, if you like?
I mean, I think they came around. The growth of collateral warranties wasn't necessarily a response to the gap in terms of third-party rights, but to a change or an evolution in the law of delict in the late 80s, early 90s, and the extent to which people who weren't parties to a contract could recover for pure economic loss, which is the loss caused by defects rather than physical damage. Now, that's a complicated area in itself. So suffice to say, for present purposes, there are a number of reasons why we have collateral warranties in terms of the way that it gives parties control over their liability. And I think the use will be required by parties almost as a, often as a comfort, that there is a route to recover for losses where that might otherwise be cut off through insolvency of other parties or for a host of other reasons. I think that generally the driver for having them is from the funders and the insurers, the people who have a financial stake in it. And it's a way, I think, probably in terms of controlling their finances. I don't know if Craig has anything else to add at this point.
No, just that having had some discussion with colleagues on this, that they've pointed out that in past eras, if you wanted a building built, then you went to a builder and the builder actually did the building. But in more complex times, as we now live in many cases, the person you think is the builder will actually be little more than a manager and will organise under his umbrella a whole raft of highly specialised people dealing with electrical equipment or heating and whatever. And therefore, the real expertise lies not in the hands of the builder that you think you have the contract with, but with these very specialist contractors. And part of the reason for the rise of the collateral warranty, I think, is so that those who want to then know who to blame and who to recover from can go direct to the party who is responsible for what the particular defect is, which is usually not something simple like bricks and mortar. It's usually something very technical and very difficult. And I suspect that's why there's been this tendency to now have lots of people with legal obligations.
I think the other, in terms of the interests of the funders, there are step-in rights that are often used in collateral warranties, which is where the funder can take on control over the contractor. And that's something where there is identified, I think, in the literature in England, a possible gap with their legislation. Because that would also, that would mean transferring not just a benefit, but also, to some extent, an obligation. Having said that, the discussion that there has been in England that I'm aware of suggests that that gap can be filled by drafting the contracts appropriately, rather than necessarily requiring any fix in the legislation. And will only occur really in the sort of complex commercial situations where the resources are worth putting in to make sure that those provisions are appropriately contained within the contract.
Okay. It strikes me that in these very complex commercial examples, the collateral warranty is a bit like a comfort blanket that people won't want to let go of too easily. How will, you know, the investors, people that are putting the big money, how will they be persuaded over time to detach from this comfort blanket?
I intend to use the word comfort blanket because I was going to use that metaphor myself, so I'm grateful for that. I think there is a possible gap opening up in England. Now, I would again say no more than it's a possible gap, but we all, I think you've heard many times, and we've all had experience, and when Mr. Connell was referring to chasing after collateral warranties, my face was darkening at memories of having to do that myself when in practice. So the problems with, the logistical problems of collateral warranties are well known. There are also issues which have emerged in case law, both in England and in Scotland, about enforcing parties' obligations to provide collateral warranties. There's a case Liberty Mercy against Cuddy in England and a case involving Keir Construction in Scotland where the court had to make an order to force a party to produce it. So it can be difficult to procure the collateral warranties. And these case laws have come out in the last couple of years. These decisions have come in the last couple of years. So have, you know, really given, brought to light that this is something that is a problem. And there have been a number of decisions which have perhaps been surprising in terms of the interpretation of collateral warranties. The case of Parkwood, where it was held that the 1996 housing grants legislation applied to collateral warranties, was seen as a surprise. And so perhaps, and some commentators have remarked on this as well, perhaps there is some shaking of the faith in collateral warranties as the kind, that sort of mixed metaphor, as the foundation of the comfort blanket for collateral warranties. And it might be that as third party rights have become established, and I think Mr. Beale's research has established that they are at least you know, becoming more, Professor Beale, sorry, they are becoming more recognised in England, that you would have the opposite of the death spiral, which is a virtuous cycle, whereas people think, well, collateral warranties aren't as great as, or as much of a security blanket as we've hoped for. Let's think about whether third-party rights can be used instead. And in support of that, at least the Joint Contracts Tribunal have produced, as part of their standard form, a schedule which sets out some detailed provisions for third-party rights. So there's support from it from one of the standard forms. And the people that draft the standard forms, and I'm conscious I'm going on a bit, but the people that draft the standard forms are commercial bodies, so they wouldn't go to the time and effort of pulling those documents together if there wasn't some demand for it or some benefit that they could give for doing that. I think I mentioned in my paper that NEC have also is another standard form contract. If they also might have a schedule, but I couldn't actually find that when I was looking for it. But certainly there's provision within the other standard forms to allow for third-party rights too. So these are bodies that are looking to sell their standard forms to parties to use in their construction projects, and they think it's worthwhile. So there is, I think, at least a growing baseline for support in England for third-party rights, which I think would also help those parties operate in England and Scotland to be more comfortable with those as a form of protecting their interests.
Why do you think that shift is happening now in England and Wales, some 18 years after the Act came into force?
There's often, well, possibly these three factors are a growing zeitgeist, and sometimes you're not quite sure how these things emerge in terms of legal reforms. There needs to be a gap that they fill. It may be that there's been, following, you know, 2007 and all that, a growth in litigation on these sort of things, a growth in litigation generally, or arguments generally, and that's promoted some cases to come to light where people have taken points that they might not have used in previous years. When the financial crash, financial crash led to significant downturn in the construction industry, and it may be that there was I can't recall the exact statistics just now, but it may have been that certain arguments were run as a means of promoting a dispute that might not have been run in the past. So, for example, you may have explored, or it may have put more stress on the legal system's rules, which have now allowed certain points to be taken. And the more that you take these points, then other people think, well, actually, maybe there is something in this. Let's try this argument.
It's going to be a slow burn. That's quite simple. Nothing is going to change overnight. People are accustomed to working the way they've been accustomed to work. My own guess is it will take an example of a third-party right in a construction contract actually being successfully relied upon, perhaps either in a what I might describe as a public dispute, or possibly in a dispute that happens behind the scenes under one of the dispute resolution procedures that the construction industry have, and it will then spread that, you know, contractor X successfully used, you know, remedy Y, and then somebody else will think, oh, that sounds as if it might save us some paperwork.
If the Act is, or the Bill is enacted, and there continues to be, I suppose, a reliance on collateral warranties, is that something that people should be troubled by? I mean, we've sort of heard sort of mixed reports about collateral warranties, a bit of a safety net and comfort blanket is familiar, but at the same time I'm picturing like a sea of paperwork and quite difficult transactions. So, you know, to what extent will it be a problem if people do continue to turn to warranties?
Difficult to describe it as a problem. I mean, it's just a little bit of unnecessary paperwork, and given that you still have all the negotiation detail to do anyway, it is just that last bit where it's the difference between putting the terms down in a contract and creating a whole series of different contracts and then persuading all the people that agreed to give them to give them. I'm not sure I would describe it necessarily as a problem, but clearly if it is more admin than is needed, then it's better to remove it.
And Mr. O'Connell, agree with your colleague, Mr. Christie, that it's a suboptimal solution, as he colourfully describes it in his evidence.
I think it can be a suboptimal solution in some straightforward circumstances. I'm just conscious that we're talking here about replacing a general principle of law. We're not talking here about, you know, creating an ideal structure for contract X, and I suspect there's a fair number of what we're calling collateral warranties, as if they were all the same, which contain much more detailed provisions which aren't going to be replicated, and those will still, I imagine, continue. I mean, Mr. Christie's reference step-in rights, it may be quite difficult to structure things to create all of the different obligations and rights that would then flow.
I think I'd agree with that interpretation of my own remarks. The point, I think, about the coexistence of third-party rights and collateral warranties, I mean, I suppose the simple point is I'm not aware of a particular unhappiness with the 1999 Act in England, where they use collateral warranties and third-party rights. I don't think there's a suggestion that legislation isn't of some use. It may be of limited use, but it is of some use, and there are some indications that it may be of growing use, albeit that's not altogether clear, but it's very difficult to get hold of the detail on that.
The position we're seeking to try and grasp or try and find is that, notwithstanding your reservations, this represents progress rather than the alternative to progress.
Yes, I think my opening point was that people should have options, and third-party rights are recognised in Scots law today, but they're not recognised in a way that is as useful as it could be for those involved in construction projects. So to clarify the law is a good idea, and it would provide parties in construction contracts in Scotland with another option about how they go about protecting their interests, and the same options they have in other jurisdictions.
Thanks very much, Mr. McMillan. I'm not sure if there's much I have to say on that, but on you go, or perhaps not. Finally then, I'll turn to arbitration. And do you have any comments on Section 9 of the Bill, which allows arbitration agreements between contracting parties to operate in respect of third-party rights? And the Faculty of Advocates were less than flattering about that.
Mr. Christie and I had a lengthy 1.5-minute conversation about this before we started to give evidence, convener. I suspect it depends on what the point of the provision is. If the idea is that you should get to a position where all disputes which, in a general sense, arise from the contract should be handled in the same type of way, then the logic of saying that the third parties should also deploy arbitration is, I think, compelling. And the odd thing, perhaps, is that the if it's assumed that many of these circumstances will be in construction contracts generally don't have arbitration as their first port of call. They have a thing called adjudication as a dispute resolution mechanism. They may have other dispute resolution mechanisms, particularly a thing called expert determination, which is simply an agreement to refer to a skilled person on a particular matter whose decision is binding. And there may be other dispute resolution mechanisms within the contract. And if the logic that drives that provision is that third parties should use the same suite, then I might have expected a wider provision than just one that focused on arbitration, because it happened to be a statutory scheme that's recently in force. Arbitration was the dispute resolution mechanism of choice for construction when I was a lad. It's now not much used in practice at all, and in construction. It's almost always adjudication, either adjudication in terms of a contractual set of provisions, or there's also an overlay by statute, which Mr. Christie mentioned earlier. So I suppose my comment is, I see the logic of everybody using the same system, but I was a little surprised to see it was just restricted to arbitration, because if the logic is you, the third party, should come in and use the same mechanisms, then I would have thought they should all be available.
It would stand to reason if the logic of the bill is to offer more choice, then it would be reasonable to offer more choice, would it, in terms of a dispute resolution?
Yes, I mean, to follow on from Mr. Connell's comments, and we had a, it was interesting that we'd come to the same question independently, and it was arbitration was the topic I left for my train journey down. One of my colleagues who is an expert in arbitration had a look and, you know, didn't have much to fault the drafting off on the particular point of arbitration. But I was interested and I was reflecting on what the difference between arbitration in this context is and other forms of alternative, i.e. non-court dispute resolution. There's a particular issue with construction adjudication because in England and Wales they had a decision where the statutory scheme was held not to apply by default to third-party rights in England and Wales. But there would be nothing to stop that being brought in by contract if the parties agreed it. Adjudication is quite intensive. It lasts 28 days. So bringing in a third party adds an extra layer of complexity to that, which might be a policy reason not to include adjudication. But then there are maybe reasons why you would bring in adjudication as an option and all sorts of other forms of alternative dispute resolution. So I wasn't able to satisfy myself that there was a good reason not to bring that into the bill as well, but I wasn't able at the same time to work out exactly how you would do it. I think the only reason why arbitration is different to some extent is that there is a role for the state in the enforcement of arbitration awards, which doesn't necessarily exist in other forms of dispute resolution, which are more purely contractual. So it might be that which is the differentiator. And there's also a possible issue that the borderlines between some arbitrations and some forms of other alternative dispute resolution aren't altogether clear in law. The definition isn't necessarily fixed. So I think there's scope potentially to consider bringing in other forms of dispute resolution. And I think there would be sense, for the reasons Mr. Connell's outlined, in reflecting on that.
Thanks, that's very helpful and certainly allows to take that up with others subsequently. Mr. McMillan.
Yeah, thank you. Just it's on that point regarding the arbitration. I think it was two sessions ago that the Parliament introduced and passed updated legislation on arbitration. And I think notwithstanding some of the earlier questions and comments regarding the updating of Scots law to make it more competitive, with the introduction of that particular legislation, I don't know what the thinking is, so I'm hence reason for posing the question to you, but could that not be one of the reasons why the focus has been about arbitration as compared to having a wider suite of options, so that that legislation, which is now updated, could be the focus for dispute resolution?
I'm not sure, to be honest. I suspect it's there because the very reform that you're discussing moved arbitration out of a collection of case law-led material and some very old statutory provisions into a single suite of all-encompassing statutory controls. And therefore, it's in everybody's mind that you need to make sure that nothing here cuts across or fails to fit with the relatively recent legislation. I think my question had been the slightly broader one. You know, is there a broader point to this? You know, is the intention that if the third party exercises their rights, they should do so in accordance with the same suite of provisions that other parties to the contract would exercise, or not? And I confess I haven't studied the matter in sufficient detail to know the answer to that question. It just seemed to me to be one that might be worth pondering before anything is finalised.
Similarly, I think I don't think there's any reason not to include arbitration the way it's currently included, and I think it's more whether that particular principle ought to be adopted more broadly or not, as Mr. Connell said. But I think the interest in aligning arbitration in Scotland with other jurisdictions is useful and seems to be met from what my colleague said in terms of the basic drafting here, notwithstanding the comments of the faculty, which I haven't gone into in detail.
It's fair to say that you know, this Parliament and the Scottish Government and a whole range of other bodies are currently actively promoting arbitration in Scotland as a dispute resolution mechanism. And it may well be that parties had in mind that anything that could be done to assist that process would be useful.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Is there anything further you wish to add?
One final question, convener. It's just we've talked a lot in the sessions about the sort of speed of law reform in this area, and we've heard that some of the problems in the Scots law and third-party rights have been around since at least the Second World War. I just wondered what your own reflections are on that. I mean, is that something that you think is a sort of fair assessment? Has it been too slow? Just any final comments on that?
The difficulty with law reform is achieving agreement on what the reform should be. Quite often you find that, you know, one party's real problem is another party's real advantage, to be blunt, and you get very conflicting views as to whether there should or should not be a change in the law. In other cases, people may have a wide range of views. And I suspect one of the real challenges of any form of law reform is to achieve a consensus. I think there is probably a legitimate criticism that if you get to cases where there is a pretty broad consensus that there should be change, no one has quite cracked moving swiftly to make that change in an ideal way. I think other speakers have spoken about it being better now than it was, and that must be undoubtedly correct. And this Parliament has been working to find ways of making that easier and swifter, which is all a good thing. I'm not sure we're quite there yet. I was instancing to Mr. Christie an example where I found an error in a piece of Scots law about time limits. Clearly an error. There was no dubiety about it. I raised it with the Scottish Law Commission. They said, oh, well, we can't deal with it because it's not on our programme of activities at the moment. So, sorry, you'll need to take it up with this division of the Scottish Government, to whom I then communicated, and I never heard any more about it. And that was the end of it. Now, it so happens that it's now being dealt with by the Law Commission in a process to deal with the law of prescription more generally. They're sort of tagging it on to the end because they can now do that. But I suspect there are things that people spot that still could be done faster, and we're all probably all constantly thinking of ways of achieving that.
I was going to just add as a supplementary, now that this is on the radar and there's a commitment to reform, I suppose in general terms, what are the expectations within the legal profession? Because we've talked a lot about what some of the limitations might be, some of the challenges, and ultimately it's about, you know, improving something. But, you know, are people, you know, optimistic, or do they have a close interest in this and how it develops?
I suspect this is not on most people's radar at all. It's too esoteric a topic. In the world of the legal profession now, people are becoming increasingly devoted to working in little boxes. People do personal injury cases, or people do construction cases, or whatever. And if whatever is going on isn't sitting in your box, you're probably not putting your heads up. I'm perhaps an exception now, because I'm old enough to come from an era when most of us did everything, and I've sort of, and some of the bar are the same. Academia as a whole is the same, because there's usually someone in academia who's looking at a particular area. But it can be quite difficult to raise interest in anything that's not, you know, landing on your desk every day of the week.
On the speed of law reform generally, which is the first question, I suppose one of the things about collateral warranties I mentioned earlier is that they only really became a thing in the early 90s, which was then followed by legislation in 1999 in England. And then the position Scotland, I suppose, has followed on behind that. But there's been a testing ground for third-party rights in England to see how they're going, and they haven't necessarily changed practice, so perhaps it wasn't necessary. You know, it wasn't demonstrated as a burning issue, which needed to be resolved before then. I think in terms of law reform, when a problem arises, there is, well, in order to be a successful reform, it has to fill a gap And so identification of the gap and clear identification of the gap and an urgency in fixing the gap are probably necessary. It's interesting, I think, to compare the 1999 Act in terms of its impact with the 1996 construction legislation, which introduced adjudication, among other things. Now, that's mandatory, so it's of a very different character, but that took off immediately and has been, you know, had a massive impact on construction law. But it was mandatory, and I don't think you would suggest that the third-party rights should become mandatory as a way of promoting them. But I think not only was that legislation mandatory, but it also captured a moment in the zeitgeist in terms of people being ready for this change to happen. I think, and there was a lot of industry consultation and publicity around that. This is probably more technocratic reform. I think it's necessary for the reasons I've said already, but I don't think it's necessarily something where people are crying out for a particular solution on the streets of Aberdeen, Glasgow, or Edinburgh. Did I have anything else I want to say? I think I'll leave it there.
It's been very helpful.
Well, thank you very much, gentlemen, Mr. Christie and Mr. Connell, for taking the time to come and give us your elegant thoughts on these matters today. We are very much in your debt, as with other witnesses, and as I've said to other witnesses, should any other matters occur to you on reflection on your discussion on the train back home, perhaps, or subsequently, do let us know, because we would be grateful for your further considerations. But in the meantime, thank you both very much for taking the time today. Thank you. Now suspend the meeting momentarily before we move into private.